Blackstone Audio presents Defending the Free Market, The Moral Case for a Free Economy by Reverend Robert Sirico. This book is read by Mike Chamberlain. For Chris Allen Morin. Sirach, Chapter 6, Verses 14 to 17. Introduction. The end of freedom? Have you ever seen a photograph of the Earth at night? Lights are scattered across the globe, wherever human beings live and work and prosper. But there's a strange blank shape at the top of the Korean peninsula, all the more remarkable because the lower half of the peninsula, South Korea, is a blaze of luminosity. The dark patch above it is socialist North Korea, where the people live in such desperate poverty that their country is dark at night. The one tiny point of light is Pyongyang, where party elites enjoy the fruits of the miserable labor of the North Korean people, who are essentially slaves. Otherwise, North Korea is simply dark. The illuminated lower half of the peninsula offers us a vision of what the world looks like with freedom, the freedom to create, prosper, and, as is so obvious, even to illuminate. But you also have in that photograph an image of what the world might look like were the torch of human liberty to sputter out, casting civilization into darkness. Surely, some will say, the possibility is only alarmist rhetoric. Surely things will go on, as they ever have. Has it not been always thus? In response to that question, I would merely point to human history. The lesson is plain. Civilizations fail. The reason they fail is also plain. When civilizational virtues are eroded from within, people lose the capacity to defend the good things those habits enabled previous generations to achieve. Think of ancient Greece, or the Roman Empire, or Germany in the 1930s. There are many other examples. We need to look around us. Aside from the two world wars, the current global debt level is unprecedented. When one generation borrows more than the next generation can ever expect to repay, a society eventually reaches a tipping point. And consider the demographic winter that is rapidly descending on Europe. Have Europeans lost hope and are therefore losing the desire to have children? Or has raising children simply become too much of a bother for a culture increasingly interested in the pleasures of the moment? In either case, the consequences are heavy. All the talk of a pension plan crisis in Europe masks what is really a moral crisis. Europe is growing sterile, and the bonds that link one generation to the next have been weakened by a nanny state that has taken over many tasks previously filled by parents caring for their children, and children caring for their aging parents. The result is an aging population who, in many cases, are alienated from their children. In such a context, who will willingly produce the multitude of goods and services the European elderly will require to enjoy the many idle years they hope for? All of the financial sleight of hand in the world will not remove the problem of fewer and fewer workers being asked to produce goods and services for a growing number of retirees, whom the workers may have little personal connection with or affection for. Even within the United States, there is an evident tendency in the same direction. Our birth rate has dropped to just over the replacement rate, with a growing number of young men and women opting to relax and enjoy the fruits of our prosperity rather than raise a new generation to carry it on. At the same time, the penchant for hedonism over hard-achieved excellence leaves many young Americans from middle-class families vulnerable to simply being outcompeted by the more industrious in an increasingly global labor market. Then, too, consider the breakdown of trust, integrity, and responsible freedom that contributed mightily to the continuing financial crisis, which began in 2008. All of these trends have one thing in common: a selfish failure to look beyond our own lives. The attitude is perfectly summed up in the words of the economist whose misguided theories have done so much to steer many nations into bankruptcy. John Maynard Keynes said, "In the long run, we are all dead." In that single sentence, he captured everything that was missing from his economic worldview and much of what's wrong with America and the world today. Too many of us have lost hope. We may expect to have fun tomorrow or over the upcoming weekend, but a more richly imagined hope, one whereby we project and pledge ourselves to a future characterized by human flourishing for ourselves and future generations.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.